So just to begin on this, so if you look at how India has changed since independence, I think this is a fact that everyone knows very well, right? So what I'm plotting here is just time, and on the y-axis is the share of either agriculture, industry or services in India as a share of GDP. And so what you can see is the stark decline of agriculture. Now agriculture as of 2010 only contributes to about 15% of GDP. Okay, as of GDP. Of course, in employment it's a different story. As a fraction of employment, it's still a large sector. But you can see this is what we in economics call structural transformation, right? So putting people from farms into firms, right? The interesting pattern, of course, is between services and manufacturing, right? What you can see is most of this growth, this decline in agriculture in the post-90s or something has been driven by services. Manufacturing has sort of stagnated somewhere around 20-25%, okay? Whereas it's really the services boom that you hear about, right, that has been contributing to the rise or the growth in GDP. And as of, I think, 2013, it's almost nearing 60% now. So 60% of Indian GDP is coming through service sectors, okay? And of course, you'll see that industrial policy is changing to adapt to that. And one thing that is coming from the government, for example, is now a serious study, or like until now, we used to have ASI type data sets, which covers manufacturing, but not services, right? And this is the first time that we're actually thinking seriously about rolling out a survey for service sectors, right? Precisely because of, you know, majority of the GDP is coming from it, okay? So with that in mind, some other cuts of the data. This is just looking at the number of firms and the number of people in India. This comes from the economic census. So you have about four rounds of the economic census. And what you can see is number of firms are growing, right? There's been massive increase in the number of firms as well as employment. So right now, Indian industry, so this includes manufacturing and services, accounts for about 130 million people are employed in industry, okay? Which sectors have grown over the past so many decades? So what you can see is, sorry, not decades. This I think is between 2005 and 2012. So it's fairly recent. And this comes from the India Industrial Production Index, the IIP. What you can see is, in general, industry has grown, manufacturing has grown, right? And growth has been driven primarily by communication, right, and electrical transport. So infrastructure in a broader way, along with communication industry. These are the fastest growing industries, at least in the past 10 years or so. And I mean, other industries is growing slower, I guess. Okay. This is very interesting, and I think it's a well-known fact, at least for people who work on firms in India. What is really surprising is, or what is really a matter of research interest or policy interest, is this huge left tail. So what am I plotting here? I'm plotting that on the x-axis is the size of the firm, so number of employees. So either it's a one employee, 2 to 5, 6 to 10, or greater than 10. And the green bars are the fraction of firms that lie in that bin, okay? So what you can see is about, just on the green bars right now, 95% of firms in India actually have less than 5 people, 95%. And remember, the number of firms that we had was somewhere around 60 million firms. 95% of them are very, 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 very tiny, right? And only 1% of firms, 1%, this is, by the way, the ASI samples greater than 20, okay, firms. And 1% of firms in the entire census are actually greater than 10 workers. So you can imagine the ASI is capturing what distribution in this entire firm distribution, okay? However, if you look at employment, it's the other way around. Not exactly the other way around, but the top 1% of firms are capturing or employing 20% of people. That's why they're important, right? They're really large, but they're really, I mean, they're really small in number, but they're really large in size. They're accounting for a lot of people, and that's why we should care about them. Because 20% of your workforce is in these firms. However, you can still see this very 69 to 70% of employment comes from these small firms. So I think industrial policy, that's why you hear a lot about, even in the current political discourse, you'll hear a lot about these small firms and MSMEs and why it's important, and why should we care about them? And we'll talk a little bit about how industrial policy has tried to deal with this. Remember that in some sense, it is unclear from a research standpoint whether this is optimal or not. In the sense, if you look at resources, so I have some resources available in the economy, I have to distribute them to people, right? Now, you could have models where one firm acquires the entire economy, right? So if you have homogeneous goods and you're the most productive firm, you should capture the entire market, right? However, it's not obviously, you know, what we observe in reality. And there's this great paper by Shi and Klinau. I don't know if you've read that. But basically what they're trying to argue is, if I compare this distribution to a distribution of firms in developed countries, say the US is their favorite example, you see that that distribution is more right skewed, as in their larger firms in the US, right? And so using that, what they're trying to back out is the level of misallocation. How misallocated are resources in the Indian economy, okay? And there seems to be fair amount of misallocation.
So when you say firms, these are firms owned by India or?
India, this is all domestic economy, absolutely, yes. Okay, another pattern which I found was interesting is, so it's not that, so this is coming from the latest economic census, which is 2012. However, this pattern basically has existed all over time. So it's not that something different is happening only in this census. So just to make that point, that firms have always been small, no matter which economic census you look at, okay? And have been capturing over 90% of the number of firms which are small. Now, this is basically telling you from the economic census, how are firms distributed across different sectors, okay? So again, the same, green is always the number of firms and orange is the amount of labor. So in the latest economic census, for example, you can see retail occupies a large number of firms as well as employment. About a quarter of people are working in the retail sector, right? You're saying that 23% of firms are employing 18% of people. Yeah, so firms could be inefficient. That's one very simple argument, that you're not operating at efficiency, right? So if you have inefficiencies, you have frictions, borrowing constraints, weather shocks, like it depends on where these things are coming from, right? But yeah, so it's worth investigating. So again, like the part of this is just to first show you the patterns. We'll come to some of the policies that we have tried evaluating in the past and seeing where this is coming from. This is, I think, something that caught my eye very recently, but something that I've started working on with the World Bank now, which is the fact, which is the following. If you look at distribution across gender, it's well known across the world, India is not an example to this, is that female-owned firms are usually lesser than male-owned firms. So in India, for example, about 16% of firms and about 14% of employment is in firms that are owned by females, okay? And you can see that they're basically also different in what sectors they operate in, right? So for example, there are more female-owned firms in agriculture than, say, retail, okay? So there's the distribution. So there's sorting across sectors. Female-owned firms also operate in sectors that are, you know, different, right? However, if you look at, so do I have it here? Yes, okay, cool. So let me actually show you this pattern first and then jump back. What you see is that female-owned firms are also much smaller than male-owned firms, okay? So they're operating in different sectors like agriculture as opposed to say retail infrastructure. They're smaller, right? That's another thing. And the other thing is that I don't have that. But female-owned firms are more likely, however, to employ more females, okay? So for example, in female-owned firms, percentage of female employees is about 70%. If a firm is owned by a female, 70% of the firm's employees are going to be female. In the males, it's about 20%, 25% tops, right? Now, why is that important? For two reasons. One is obviously you have this entire problem about female labor force participation in India and females are not coming and working, etc. Now that, and you have this problem about female entrepreneurs being smaller and facing constraints, right? So right now, some stuff that we are starting to work with are trying to understand the challenges faced by these female entrepreneurs, right? Is it truly the, so one purely academic reasoning could be that female-owned firms are just comparatively disadvantaged than male firms. That's obviously like a theoretical reason why you have smaller firms. Females are less productive, for example, right? But clearly, that's not true, right? And one would not like to believe that. So if you run regressions, for example, you put in, you know, industry fixed effect, right? What does that do? That's basically taking into account sorting. Why? Because now I'm looking at only within industry comparisons, right? Because once I put a fixed effect, I'm taking into account variation across industries. The variation left is only now within an industry. Even then, these patterns will survive, okay? And so then the question, and I'll come to in the theory, this has some nice implications. We are trying to first figure out how big a problem is this for the economy. And then the next step is what can we do about it? And so then just jumping back, one problem that seems to be persistent is basically sources of finance, right? Where do males and females borrow from, right? 88% of male-owned firms are self-financed, which means by the household, you know, you're not borrowing from either formal or informal sources, family and friends, right? The massive difference is in informal borrowing, right? Female firms are just twice as likely to borrow informally than male-owned firms, okay? So the point of, I think, these two slides is to highlight or throw out this pattern that, look, these are smaller firms, they're operating in different sectors, but there are systematic differences in how they're employing people, which types of people, specifically gender, that they're employing, right? And what can be the implications of these? I think something that I've been very recently interested in. So after this very broad overview of just how industry in India looks like, let's actually jump into some of the industrial policies that India has had over the past 50 years, 60 years. So in general, as a policymaker, and of course, many people in the room will have more experience at this than I have, every government or every policymaker goes in with the right intention, which is what? Firms are constrained, right? The reason you have 95% of firms below 5 workers is not because that's their optimal size, right? What do you mean by optimal size? From a purely economic standpoint, profit maximizing, right? Your L stars and K stars or inputs, for example, are not optimal, right? There might be constraints, there might be frictions that might be banning you. What could some of them be? You can have, say, for example, access to resources. So capital borrowing, labor hiring might be constrained. Access to markets, selling your goods in the finished markets, for example, might be a problem. Upstream, downstream effects might be a problem. Technology and skill training, the world is changing fast. So you need to adapt to different technologies, that might be harder. And protection from quote-unquote market forces, which means what? IKEA and Reliance going and gobbling up everyone, right? So you want to hopefully protect them for some reasons, protect these firms, right? Now, what is the problem? As a policymaker, what I've told you right now is obvious. I don't think this needs more selling, right? But imagine as a policymaker, what do you think is the main problem in designing an industrial policy? Suppose my industrial policy had to deal with capital. So government runs subsidies, right? Lending subsidies and stuff. What is the problem?
Again, what is the objective exactly of the policymaker?
You have these frictions in the market.
Okay, to reduce it.
Yeah, hopefully. Exactly. Like in any other case, right? Mostly is identifying the frictions is fine. The problem is targeting is hard, right? So for example, where is the next Ratan Tata in India, right? Now, the whole problem is that one theory could be to say that, well, firms are small not because they're unproductive. You might have a really productive entrepreneur, but he's really poor, for example. And so like, if that person were to be as rich as Ratan Tata, he would have built a massive empire for himself or herself. Right? So the problem is targeting. Okay, now if targeting is hard on ability, basically, right? Suppose entrepreneurial ability is really hard to identify, right? So then what do you do as a policymaker?
You may incentivize.
Yes. Take any other example, like health, poverty reduction programs, right? It's very hard to identify real poverty, right? So what do governments do? They target based on some rule, right? Your BPL, you get some benefits, right? Similarly here, mostly you target based on observables, even in industrial policy. That's why most industrial policies are either going to be sector specific, product specific, or size specific, or space specific. These three bullet points will cover the universe of almost all industrial policies in any country, right? Now, of course, this throws up interesting questions from an economic analysis point of view, right? For example, size-based policies. What does this mean? It means that if the firm is below a certain threshold, right? In India, size-based policies are based on capital stocks, so the gross value in plant and machinery. The rule is, if you're below that threshold, you will get some benefits from the government. Okay, you're excluded from taxes, you can have access to loans, so on and so forth, right? Now, the trade-off that you have is, on the one hand, arguably, the smaller firms are also more constrained. So this is aimed at motivating or alleviating that constraint, correct? That's the direct this thing. Can you think of other problems? What is the flip side of that story? What are you incentivizing firms to do now? Stay small, right? So that's another trade-off. Like, sure, they might be constrained, but sure, also, like, larger firms who would have wanted to grow, right, are now staying small. So from an economic efficiency point of view, right, you don't know what these trade-offs are. What should the government be doing? And that's why I think in this makes it an exciting area of research, just because answers are here very ambiguous, right? It's not a right or a wrong answer on what could happen. And we'll talk through some concrete papers that have tried to deal with this and what they find, but that's essentially the policy, right? Spatial policies is the same thing. Uttarakhand has this policy of, you know, they want to promote certain types of industries, for example, right? And so they're heavily subsidizing, like Gujarat did that for a long time, where they were heavily subsidizing, they create special economic zones and all of those things, incentivizing industry to come in, right? Of course, that has a lot of effects on other things as well, like not only industrial activity, but labor markets, education, migration, right? And so it's all basically interlinked. And so you can't separately just study industrial policy without like taking into account spillovers onto other labor markets, spillovers onto human capital accumulation, education, migration, services, infrastructure. There's just a lot of things that come in with this, right? So now, before I dive into some papers, what I want to discuss is essentially lay out what people have done in the past and where we are right now, okay? So broadly, I mean, this shouldn't be a surprise if you've taken an undergrad course in economics. I'm sure at some point you must have sat through excruciating pain on policies since independence. We had a course in DU, 1947 to something, something, 1991 or something, right? Any DU alums? Right. Ha, Indian Economic Development. So essentially, industrial policy can be divided broadly into these three categories, right? What we call the plan period, which was the whole Nehruvian era, then the license raj, the end of the license raj, and then post-liberalization in 91, what we now call the new industrial policy, okay? So this is just to give you a background, because I'm not sure how familiar people are with industrial policies in India, or if you even care about this. If not, you can take a nap, as some people are already doing. So then, industrial policy resolution. So industry basically passed, in 1947 to 80 was the protectionist era, right? So you had industrial, the main act, which still is very relevant, is the IDRA, the Development and Regulation Act in Industries. That regulated a lot of hiring, firing, entry, exit decisions of these firms. And with certain amendments, this still is in force today, right? With some amendments. And essentially, when this was passed, the whole idea in the protectionist era was to subsidize heavy industries, right? And so this classification I always find funny, where industries were, or firms were classified either as public, mostly public, or other. You could only be categorized into these three, okay? Industries. And so that was classification and subsidization. What the government also instituted were a lot of protections with respect to which sectors you could enter, which products you could manufacture, so on and so forth. For example, like one of the things was they reserved some products that only small firms could manufacture, like jute bags, slippers. I mean, if you've grown up in India, in my childhood, I could never imagine why this brand would exist, right? Because there are some random brands, And I grew up in, when Pune was that time a very small place. So now I know, because they were reserved. So you couldn't have Coke come and enter and give you Coca-Cola. So you had random like gold spot, which was amazing, but I never knew why it existed. Import-export tariffs, of course, licenses, tariff barriers, so on and so forth. So this was an era where basically there was a lot of protection, right? Now, of course, the problem is, if you want to evaluate any of this in terms of what was the implications that this had on the economy, you can't, because you don't have data on firms, right? So most of the analysis that I'll consider starts from the 1980s, when, quote unquote, reliably we have some ASI data and some NSS data to hold bearing on how these policies impacted what it did. So 1980s to 90s, as you might know or have heard, are where they started dismantling all of these licenses, the end of the license raj, essentially. And so where are we in terms of measuring the impact? So how would you measure the impact is the first question, right? So suppose I want to look at, I think in the reading list, I had put a paper by Agion and Zilibotti and all of these other guys. And what was the idea? The idea was essentially to say, let's take a product, right, for which there was license, or an industry for which there was licensing, right? And now you de-license those industries, okay? Can someone, this is like a very practical question, but how would you think of evaluating the impact of that? You understand the question. In the 1980s, the government says, yaar, bahut licensing hai, we need to remove some licenses, okay? Suppose I pick garment industries, and I say, from 1980, garment industries, if you want to enter, exit anything, you don't need government approval. So that those weren't the only licenses, just to be clear. There were licenses on import, export, and all of these other things as well. I'm just boiling this down very simplistically. But suppose that was the idea. What I want you to think about is how would you, as policymakers or as researchers, think about evaluating such policies, right? And the government comes to you and says, ki, I want to remove licenses. What do you think will happen? Or the government does remove the licenses. You are sitting in 1990 now. So there have been 10 years of de-licensing, for example. How would you measure the impact?
So there was an intervention, right? De-licensing. Could we not do a difference in that case?
Exactly, right? So one which I think most of the literature does. So if you read any, much of the literature in industrial policies uses a difference in difference approach. That's why I spent some time in the morning discussing difference in differences, right? Because now you can imagine, so what are you studying? You're studying garments being de-licensed in 1980, for example, and you're going to look at what is, that's your treatment group in some sense, right? What's your control group? Other industries, perfectly, right? So I can compare garments to other paper industry, for example, right? And so paper industry still has licenses going on. And so then what do you compare? Yeah, pick your favorite outcome variable, right? Number of firms, employment, prices, quantity, whatever you want to do, right? And so what is the regression you might want to run? This is always the hard part. Das saal ka data hai. You have data from 1980, say 1970. Hypothetically karna hai, toh we'll go all out. 1970 to 1990, you have data on firms, okay? 1980 is when the policy kicks in, okay? Go, tell me.
Why should you compare it to rubber paper? You can do it for textile itself.
Great question. Why would you want to even need a control group? You understand the question? Exactly. India is getting richer over time, for example. Simple case, right? Then how are you going to disentangle whether number of firms increasing in textiles was because India was getting richer or whether it was the policy? Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, so that's why you need a control, because you need to take into account these factors, right? Demand changes, income changes. And by differencing it, that's the whole advantage. Not only observables, you can also difference out unobservables in difference in differences. That's the whole idea behind difference in differences. Okay, so then effectively what you do is, yes, please.
How do you choose a control group here? Like, I mean, it's like, because two industries can be like completely different. So, like, what's the mechanism through which you are choosing?
So, there have been, that's a great question, first. It's hard. That's why you have these parallel trend type assumptions, right? So, you have to figure out, like, so I think a good way, the way I at least thought about difference in differences when I was learning it, was compare it to an RCT, basically, right? So, in an RCT, what would you have done? You're basically saying, I'm randomly picking an industry and delicensing it. The only difference in difference in differences is that it's not random, right? So, but what do you want? You want industries that look like textile industries or garment industries, whichever one is. So, therefore, automobile industries maybe is not the right comparison group, right? Because the industry structure, demand, as was being pointed out, be very different, right? So, choosing industries that are comparable to the industries that were de-licensed.
Like in the same classification.
For example, right, would be, and then I'll show you why that is also a problem. Because obviously industries are linked. There is upstream, downstream linkages. Firms manufacture multiple products, so on and so forth. But that would be a good way of starting at least. Okay? Please.
So, like, this is a case of natural experiment. Huh. So, treatment is not random. For example, like, government is choosing as a policy to liberalize FDI in some sectors. Like, government decides to liberalize FDI in civil aviation. It will depend on performance of that sector only. So, there is this bias, self-selection type of bias.
Exactly. So, what do you do? Can you do better? No, I agree with you. Like, I think finding flaws in any, so jokes apart, I think finding flaws in any design is very easy. Because of course you can tell me that, oh, like, there is something going on in the rubber industry that is not there. Of course, that's true. The question is, can you do better? Right? And if not, can you highlight the limitations that you're worried about? Both are acceptable, right? But at least you make some progress.
And what's the answer to the second version of the question?
Which is?
Highlight the limitation.
Yeah, like, for example, what was being pointed out? Like, is paper industry a good control for textile industries? Right? So one test of that is the parallel trends. Right? So what do we mean by parallel trends? So what data do you have now? I'm basically saying, this is time. This is, say, whatever your outcome variable is. All I'm saying is, if I observe two industries that are parallelly growing like this, right, from 1970, and this is where the policy hits, 1980, right? And after this, this guy goes here, this guy continues straight, right? This is a reasonable case to make that difference in differences are what you should be running. You can still find problems, but that's, so now you have moved, so since you have done difference in differences, now you can actually move to synthetic controls, which means what? That instead of having one industry as your control group, you can take a weighted average of industries, right, and estimate those weights, basically, such that by construction in the pre-period, you're making the industry similar. These are all econometric tricks in a way, but the reason they help you is now by construction, you're estimating the weights such that I'm not relying completely on two, like garment versus paper. I can take garment versus all non-garment industries, right? But weight each industry's outcome variable in a way such that they look comparable. That's the idea.
In a formal sense, when you do a weighted combination, are you not essentially mathematically doing a randomization?
Not randomization, because it's...
No, I, of course, it's not a randomization literally, but I'm saying that when you take a weighted combination,
yeah,
and getting a parallel trend before the intervention,
yeah, you're enforcing this, basically. You're enforcing this.
So basically, we are trying to mimic the treated industry through...
Perfect. Perfect. Exactly. So you can, yeah, you can use synthetic controls, and then you keep the weights the constant post, right? And using that weights, it's almost as if saying, now I keep the weighting the same, and then I observe the changes that happen in my what synthetic control, which is a non-existing entity. Oh yeah, there is a paper by, so this is proposed by, let me tell you his name, Abadi, I think, who is at MIT. He was the guy who proposed this. I can send you papers. Off the top of my head, I don't remember papers. Yes, exactly. Exactly. But there are more that have used synthetic controls now. Okay. Cool. So with that, what have people found? So right now the license, so there's been some research that has gone into looking at, okay, so sorry. So before we spoil the surprise, what would you expect this would lead to? You tell me.
I think you can do a control for, if you have an idea of what controls you should do when you interact.
So what's your DID?
No, I'm saying if you have one baseline data, you don't have two baseline data for the pre-treatment, check for parallelism. You still have one baseline, and you have one post-treatment data. Can you still do a DID?
I mean, yes, but the question is, would you believe that? Econometrically, it's possible, right? You have two data points. I can always take a difference. I can always take a difference. So yes, practically, but then the question is whether whatever you get out of that, whether you should believe that or not as a causal estimate, right?
Do you have theoretical arguments in support of?
No. Sure, but all of that rely on parallel trends means that I need to show they're parallel. If I just have one point here and one point here, I have no idea what that is, right? But if that's your data limitation, then that's the best you can do, right? So you're right. Like in some cases, if you don't have data, I can't show you parallel trends, right? Yeah. So you can still do it. The question is, the caveat is, that's what I'm saying, then you should be able to recognize the limitations of that research, okay? So what do you find? You basically find increase in small firms, entry of small firms, right? Larger firms grow in size. Now this is always nice when you see this because this highlights constraints, right? Imagine if things were completely optimal, right? Everyone was profit maximizing, unconstrained profit maximizing, right? Then whether I have the policy or reduce the policy shouldn't matter, right? Because L star and whatever Y star, where Y is output, L is labor, shouldn't change if you're unconstrained maximizing, right? The fact that these things change highlight some constraints that firms might be facing, right? When you have papers that try and estimate aggregate productivity gains by relaxing these entry constraints, you have shrinking of the middle size. So you have a lot, imagine that you, because these constraints are basically not allowing the firms that wanted to grow large are not able to grow as large as they want to. So once you allow them to grow large, right, the middle is going to go down, people are going to move to the right, and entry is going to happen from the left-hand side, basically, intuitively, right? The last part was interesting. Industries actually, and this is, I think, a well-known fact in many other papers, like Besley and Burgess also, I think, have similar papers, where the idea is that industries that are located actually not in pro-worker states, but in pro-employer states, right, grow faster than states that had pro-worker regimes. Okay, the way they do that is they just classify amendments to the Industrial Acts as being pro-worker or being pro-employee, pro-employer. Okay, and then you can do a heterogeneity analysis. What do you mean by that? You can interact your treatment variable. By the way, in RCTs also you can do that, right? Do people know how to do heterogeneity analysis? If not, a crash course. Suppose I have alpha plus beta t plus gamma times, say I'm looking at gender, plus epsilon, okay? So the idea is, in RCTs, for example, or in difference in differences, either which way, if I run a regression like this, right, where what I'm saying is, I have given you a treatment, say deworming, Now I want to see whether deworming has a separate effect or a differential effect for boys versus girls. Okay, that's a perfectly valid question to ask, right? So I have data on treatment allocation, so whether you're treatment or control. I have your outcome variable, which is some health, right? And I have data on gender, whether you are male or female, okay? Now, if I run this regression, the question is, which of these terms will you look at to find the differential effect? Do you know, question is understood? Your objective is to look at whether my treatment affects boys versus girls differentially. Delta. Why delta? Good. So, or to put it another way, how can you see this? What will be the effect of the treatment if you're in control and if you're a boy? What is my, suppose this is health outcome? Alpha. Right? If you're control, but if you're a girl, alpha plus gamma, right? Similarly, if you're treatment and you're boy, and if you're treatment and if you're girl, alpha plus beta, no, all of them, right? Okay, right? So now if I take a difference here, I'm going to get gamma, difference here, and a difference in difference, okay? So what is this telling you? How do you interpret the delta is the question. The interpretation is the slightly tricky part, right? What is this coefficient telling you? Exactly. How can it be the other way around?
It's the extra benefit that the girls are getting being treated rather than being not treated.
Correct. So it's the differential effect of the treatment, right? On girls versus boys, right? What you are saying is not right. No. It's not the extra treat. If you're a girl, it's not the treatment effect is not that. That's gamma plus delta. What you are saying. If you're a girl, the extra benefit of getting treated is this difference. That's what you are saying. So that's not what we are interested in. That might be what you're interested in. These are just comparing means.
If you do that, this one in a different way, the difference means CB minus DB, and then another difference from CG by.
Oh, of course, yes.
I am interpreting it differently.
Oh, sure. You can always subtract these two first and then these two. Absolutely. That's fine. But the whole point is that you have to have a difference in difference. So it's a relative change in a relative change. It is comparing the effect of the treatment on boys, on girls, relative to boys. So there's already a treatment effect for boys. There's a treatment effect for girls. This is the relative effect of that treatment on girls versus boys. It's a difference in difference. That's the whole point. It's not a simple difference. Okay? And if you look at it, that's essentially what we did. In the earlier thing, we had just replaced this by post. Right? That's all we've done. So heterogeneity in that way. So now you could look at a difference in difference in difference. You could go crazy, right? Because suppose that now I have a baseline. New possibilities emerge, right? Because now I can look at whether a difference in difference in difference exists or not. Which means now over time as well, I have a third dimension to difference out, right? So girls versus boys, control versus treatment, and end line minus baseline, right, is what you could do, okay? But the interpretation of these, suppose I only have cross-section, is something you should understand. So this beta is telling you what? What is beta? It's simply the effect of the treatment on? No. What is that? What is beta? Exactly. Is the effect of the treatment only on boys? Right? What is gamma? Effect of what on girls? No. What is the effect of not treatment on girls?
Girls are not treated.
No, wrong. You're getting there.
If the constant along with when you're considering only girls, that is alpha plus gamma.
Perfect. So, it is the difference in my outcome variable between do you see that? This is purely the difference in boys and girls in the control group, right? Okay. So hopefully if you've understood all of this, then much of this research is going to be, instead of girls, you can just put in a whole lot of other things, right? States, pro-employer versus pro-worker states. That could be an indicator here. And my treatment is when industries got de-licensed, for example, right? But all of them are going to follow the same flavor of analysis. Okay. So now let's come to the more interesting part, which is what we call, yes, please. Oh, heterogeneity is, I could run, so instead of running this elaborate regression, I could have just run just this regression. Let's call this A. And let's call this B. Let's call this D. I could have run this regression. What is B telling me here? It's just telling me the average effect on everyone, right? I have some girls, some boys in control and treatment. This is like telling you the average effect. But suppose I wasn't interested in the average effect. I was interested in knowing whether girls had a better effect than boys or not. That's what I mean by heterogeneity, along some other characteristic of your population. Okay? Good. So now coming to the new industrial policy. So effectively what happened in 1991? It's like a well-known fact, right? India liberalized itself. Okay? Which means what? Concretely speaking, we know of it mostly as trade liberalization, right? But it was like a three-pronged approach or something, which basically means you're going to dismantle controls, abolishing licenses, etc., liberalize the economies, which means open it up for trade, reduce tariffs and barriers, as well as domestic reforms, such as promotion of small-scale industries, spatial development policies, so on and so forth, right? So what do you find? Right. So what you find basically is, I think the obvious things, right? So the reason I'm not discussing one paper in detail is because there's just so many papers on this that, you know, it's just better to give you a broader idea. And all of them are mostly going to go through a difference in different type of approaches, right? So if you have more data, you can just do all of this, but put like time trends and fixed effects and all of these things. Please.
Like if we do not perform this and rather than this,
we restrict
the sample only to girls and run this regression, that would be same.
You tell me.
Will that be same? No, it does not seem. Like what? So we would get different coefficients for boys and girls.
Correct.
We won't be able to compare them in the same manner.
Exactly. Why?
Because it does not show us the difference part of it.
I can run this separately for boys, or rather, I can run this separately for boys. I'll get a B hat boy. I can run this separately for girls. I'll do B hat girl. I can do B hat boy minus B hat girl. Will that be the same as this? If yes, why? If no, why? One, that sample size is changing. Second, sorry? Perfect. In this, what am I assuming on the structure of the error terms? They are the same, right? For the entire sample. Here, I'm assuming a separate error term for each of them. So the way I'm fitting the line, basically, imagine regressions are all they're doing is you have a bunch of scatter plots, you're fitting a line, right? And you're minimizing, all of these are basically minimizing the distance to the line. That's all you're doing in a regression, right? Now, if I give, here I'm fitting one line, period. Here you're fitting two different lines. So you have more degrees of freedom, right? To fit the data better, because now you have two lines that you can fit for the same sample. Okay?
Excuse me, sir, one more question.
Please. Okay.
And then I don't know whether, like, I don't have individual, like, you are girl or boy, but I know the population proportion of girls and boys. Then if I want to do a heterogeneity analysis, then I
But how is there heterogeneity? So good point. So the question is, I'll come to your question. That's a good question. But before I come to that, you've sparked another. Why do I need this interaction? What if I just control for, this is like controlling for gender, right? Suppose I do this. What am I getting out of this regression? Am I getting the heterogeneity that I need? If yes, why? If no, why? You understand this? You're controlling for gender. Okay? The question is, okay, Radha, what is the question that we're after? Let's start with that.
Why we need the interaction?
No, but what are the question we're after is, we want to know the heterogeneity, right? What do you mean by that? I want to see whether the treatment has different effects for girls and boys. Good? Okay. Controlling for gender, is that giving you that? Or if yes, which of this is giving you that? Or if no, why isn't it giving you that?
So it is just giving you the impact of being a girl or boy on the outcome itself, but not the effect of treatment.
Badiya. Good. Correct. Here when you're controlling for gender, you're just saying that some part of my outcome is being explained by the fact that I'm a girl or a boy. But I'm only looking at the effect of the treatment, right? I'm not looking at the treatment separately for boys and girls, right? With me? And that's why you need the, because now this allows you to have that extra variation or the slope changing basically between boys and girls. With me? Okay. Does that answer your question? No.
Sir, but do we do when you have a different unit of analysis? Like for this, I want to do this heterogeneity analysis, then how do you go about that?
Tell me. You have all the information to tell you that. Bataiye.
Interact the proportion of that.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So now, so what do you find? So coming back to trade liberalization and economy liberalization, what you essentially find is competition productivity goes up, obviously. You've liberalized the economy, competition will go up. Firm level productivity in formal and informal sectors go up, which is interesting. And we'll come to how do we measure productivity. That's another whole debate in industrial economics on what do you mean by productivity and how do you measure it. Interestingly, and this is a thing that I've been interested in, on product diversification, which means what? Basically, if you think of products, so traditionally what people have thought about as firms is single product firms, right? You manufacture paper products, right? A table, for example. In reality, however, firms manufacture more than one product. You manufacture chairs and tables, right? So the question is, industrial policies, of course, will have an effect on also not only, you know, size of firms, but also portfolio diversification. You might decide to manufacture different products, for example, and focus on products that you're more advantaged at manufacturing, so on and so forth. The last part is on prices go down, obviously because firms are becoming more efficient at manufacturing, and so they can charge lesser prices. Impact on labor markets, so this was impact on firms. Second is impact of labor. What does research have to tell us? What happened? What you find is bargaining powers of workers goes down, right? Because now competition is much higher. Second, export industries, unemployment goes down, obviously, because now they're exporting. This is the nice or the interesting thing, which is that schooling and child labor also changes. People start going to school more, child labor goes down. Why? Obviously, because now there is demand for work, right? You need to be educated, so people start going to school. And of course, what you might care as a grand policymaker, you do find reductions in poverty and increases in consumption. Okay, after liberalization. So this is, I've just cited like 10 papers on this, basically. But if you're interested in specific aspects, I would just urge you to go and read the papers. They're very nice papers in the sense, it's methodologically, if you've understood what's going on here since morning, you'll be able to follow everything that's going on in the paper, okay? Now let's move on to what happens in the last 10 years or something in terms of industrial policy. What has industrial policy focused on? Essentially, the big act that was passed in 2006 was the MSME Act, which is the Micro, Small, Medium Enterprises Development Act, right? What does that basically do? So remember micro, I mean MSMEs or SMEs as they were called earlier. MSMEs are essentially size-based policies, which they target you based on if you're small, period, right? The two important policies, or rather the one important policy that's very nice, is the dereservation of products. Remember I told you like in 1950s or 60s or so, people started reserving products. Turns out that until 2000, these products were still reserved. So if you still wanted to manufacture a table, or I think a jute bag or something, you had to be small. Large firms couldn't come and enter it, right? And so finally, around, I mean, the whole decade of 2000 was done at dereserving these products now. So over time, these products were dereserved so that people could start manufacturing these products as large firms as well, instead of being just small. Second, the MSME Act increased the size cutoff, which means what? The earlier cutoff, I think if I'm not wrong, was around 1 crore. So if your capital investment in plant and machinery is below 1 crore, you are a small firm. Here they increase it from 1 crore to 5 crores, right? So what does that mean? So think about it. If you're an industry or if you're a firm, right? Now you have three categories of firms. If you compare the before after. What are these categories? You have people who were below 1 crores, right? Who always got the treatment before the reform and after the reform, right? You have some firms who are between the 1 and 5 crores, who earlier were ineligible, but are now eligible. And then you have the greater than 5 crores, who were never eligible, and are still not eligible, correct? So now what do you have? It's another variation or a play on this. Because now instead of having two groups, control and treatment, now you have three groups, right? You have always eligible, never eligible, and one set of people who became eligible because of the policy reform, okay? And there's a lot of interesting stuff that's going on in trying to figure out. Basically, the problem with, I think, the larger point to connect to this is people don't really know whether you should have size-based policies or not, right? Our size-based, the World Bank, IMF, all of these guys are pouring millions of rupees or dollars into size-based policies, like helping out SMEs. What are the constraints to growth? And it's not really obvious from an economic standpoint, whether we are gaining anything from, you know, helping these firms to grow, okay? And so therefore, these reforms become very important to study from an economic or a research standpoint, because you can learn a lot about how firms respond, how different types of firms respond, how do they respond in terms of size, in terms of products, in terms of investment, in terms of, you know, where they're located, entry, exit, like all of these margins, okay? Second other important thing was basically spatial policies. Now, spatial economics is a new hot field in economics. And so spatial policies have, there's some very nice papers that look at the impact of these spatial policies. Why would you care about spatial policies? It's because, of course, India is connected through space, right? Space in this is not antarikshvala space, but like geography, right? So geography matters for a lot of reasons, because Delhi is getting polluted and polluted by the day because people are gathering here, right? So once you start linking up space, right, what is the problem with that now? Okay, this is interesting. Spatial policies, suppose there are a difference, right? Let's say Gujarat, hypothetical example. Gujarat basically has their SEZ, right? SEZ matlab, you're in a simple way, subsidizing firm entry, okay? What can I do? As a researcher, I can run a difference. I can compare, say, Gujarat to Maharashtra, right? Before and after the policy. Simple. What is the problem? No, adding fixed effects is fine, but what is the problem, fundamental problem in doing that comparison? Exactly. Is my control group a pure control? No. Why? Migration, for example. Right, of firms, of people, of technology, right? And so therefore, if you have like these policies, our limitations come in very, like the limitations of using what we call reduced form approaches like these are like kick in very fast, because you can't really capture spillovers very well. Perfect. Exactly. Yeah. So all of that becomes very hard to think about in a simple diff-and-diff format, right? Because your assumptions of diff-and-diff become harder and harder to justify when spillovers are apparent, right? And so that's where structural modeling, use of economic theory, is very, very useful and very, very active, okay? And so we'll talk about how can we think about evaluating policies when we know there are spillovers, when we know, and it's going to be slightly complicated. The answer obviously is not going to be simple, right? And this is not even like primary data that I can just go and collect. Imagine you have the ASI, basically, every year, right? And in 2005, there is a policy. So you don't know if people migrated, not. All I see is firm A in Gujarat, and I see firm B in Maharashtra. Earlier, Gujarat guy, Gujarat guy goes really fast, Maharashtra guy does not, right? But attributing that to the policy is very hard because of these spillovers. Of course, if you had primary data, you could solve that because you could measure it. You could go and ask people. You could look at employee compositions and see how much of that is migrant labor, how much of it is native labor, so on and so forth. But in the absence of all of that, it becomes really hard, okay? Then, of course, the huge changes in taxation policies. You moved from sales tax regimes to VAT, and then very recently to GST, right? What were the advantages of, like, why do we need VAT? Let's first come to that, then we come to GST. What is the biggest advantage of VAT? Double counting, but...
No, only value addition is taxed.
Yes, so how does that help a government? Why should I do it? Why can't I just do a sales tax and consumer coil tax? What is the biggest problem of taxation in India? Who said that? Yeah, evasion, right?
Here they can capture the number of firms actually involved in the whole process.
Exactly, why?
Because value added in each process, so they are paying the tax, so number of the firms involved in it, it's get calculated automatically from the...
Exactly, and it's your interest to declare that, right? Because if I want a credit on VAT, I need to show my value added, which means what? I need to show how much I bought from the previous guy and how much am I selling it for. So from a government point, it's like a double win, because I see your sales and I see your inputs. And that I can match to the person who said his or her inputs or our sales was whatever amount. So if I buy 100 units of input, the guy who I bought it from should say I sold 100 units of input, right? So that one thing is that gets into account the whole like informality type of angle, because the other part which I didn't show you was that India also has a huge informal base, even in firms, right? Okay, that's one. How is GST an improvement over that? Simplistically, yeah. So VAT, one of the things was that VAT was very state specific. Right, that's why you had these octroi payments that you had to make and long lines of trucks on borders, because we move from Tamil Nadu to Kerala, there's a different tax that you have to pay across the border, essentially. So where you produce and where you sell was a problem, right? And that you can have very interesting, I don't think anyone's looked at that, but you can have spatial implications of that. Where do industries grow, essentially? GST, amongst other things, apart from simplifying taxation structures and all of that, one important thing of GST is that the whole one nation, one tax idea. Right? So now borders don't matter in a way. You can produce anywhere, you can sell anywhere, it's just the same tax everywhere. Okay? Good. So these things haven't been evaluated. I mean, that's what I'm saying. Like, we're barely scratching the surface of what we know about industrial policy and how it affects things in India. And of course, there are other policies like technology, upgradation, demonetization, skill training, and we don't really know how these things have affected the way Indian industry has worked. Right? And I'm not talking of like journalistic reports, like, you know, you park yourself in one village and say what happened, that's important. But I'm talking more from a very macroeconomic perspective, how these things have affected. Okay. Yeah, one of the things in demonetization was these like Surat traders up in arms and stuff like that, right? Of course, imagine if you can't pay your supplier. Technically, people found ways around it, that's a different issue. But in theory, how are you going to pay your workers? How are you going to pay your suppliers? How are the buyers going to pay you, right? So now some work that has been done is to look at, so we'll come to this part, but One of the things with industrial policies and why they're different from RCTs, or why one should think about them as different from RCTs, is precisely because of the general equilibrium effects, right? Now, what do I mean by G? What is G?
Optimization and market theory.
Yes, but intuitively, more intuitively. No. So, okay.
When you remove the constraints, then the equilibrium outcome.
Correct. Correct. So, which means what? So, okay. So, what does this mean? This is another way. It's like a spillover in some sense, right? How? Because imagine I was giving out master's degrees for fun, okay? And master's degrees really matter because you're more high skilled, for example. Now, if you're the only one with a master's degree, he has a huge premium in getting a higher wage. Because all of you don't have master's degree, only he's the only one. Okay? Now, if I start giving everyone a master's degree, suppose I run this RCT, right? And I tell you that, oh, like, look, huge gains to having a master's degree, right? Control group, treatment group, right? Massive gains. So the government says, chalo, sabko master's de dete. What is the problem with doing that? If everyone has a master's degree, demand supply, right? Supply goes up of master's degree people, wages are going to go down. That's basically G, market clearing, demand supply. Or to put it another way, prices are not constant. Experiments or policies can have an endogenous effect on prices. That's the whole point, right? Which means both control and treatment will be affected by that, right? You're also contaminating the control group decisions because they're affected by market prices, right? And so you're contaminating the control group as well through this additional channel. So that's one, which was this paper. This other paper that I tried to write was looking at contamination from, so these are basically arguments on why you shouldn't be doing difference in differences in a nutshell. What's the second point? The second point is, suppose I de-reserve tables. Okay, and now I say, earlier chairs and tables were both reserved. Now I come and say, tables ko de-reserve kar diya. Anyone can come and manufacture tables. Okay, a naive thing would be to do, which is what? Run a difference in difference. Chairs are still reserved, tables are not. I can do a difference in difference, right, between chairs and tables. And the point I try to make in this paper is that firms are usually multi-product. They manufacture multiple products, right? And so you're obviously linking products. If I de-reserve tables, I'm automatically affecting the chair manufacturers as well. Because there are some firms who are manufacturing both. And so their decisions are going to change, which means even if I'm a single chair manufacturer, I'm going to be affected in that entire market chain. Okay? And I try to basically put a number on that. And I say that about 50% of the change that one observes only comes through this optimal allocation within a firm, instead of optimal allocation across firms. Okay? Another spillover that one can think about is upward, downward. I'm just telling you all of this just to tell you that, look, in many cases, you might find this very attractive, but try and put a little bit more effort to think about the theory and think about how you want to evaluate this or where can this be affected instead of running, you know, like stuff like that. And these are large industrial policies that you're not going to be able to randomize, right? So randomization is out of the window on day one. Don't even think about it. These were not randomized at all. Right? And so what can we do better? Okay? Which is what we'll come to in a bit.
Are we moving towards a structural equation?
Yes. In 10 slides, 5 slides. Good. So now, one part of where we are on labor law amendments as well is it's obvious that labor laws, the more inflexible they are, the more they're going to slow down growth. So what do you find? This is the interesting part, or at least when I was reading this in my undergrad, it was interesting, which is the more pro-worker changes you make, the negatively it affects you, almost in any dimension that you might consider. Take anything, output, labor, capital, productivity, right? If a state, this is all state level changes, if states go more pro-worker, it's harming firms. which in turn means they're employing less labor, less capital, less resources on the economy, which means it's going to depress. Like, there's the whole like domino effect, right? Contract workers go up, right? Which we all know by now. And the last part is on economic disparities across space, so regional economic disparities. And there what we find is, sure, like if you make things better, like you introduce SEZs and all of these things, firms respond. So that's, I mean, you can read, Ritam Chauri has a lot of work on this, trying to look at space-based allocations. So now let's take a step back. So that's all I had on sort of policies, but now let's take a step back and view industrial policies and try and understand what are we getting at or how do we want to do it. So the first question is, when we say we are measuring the impact of these policies, the first question we want to ask is measuring the impact of what? Sorry, on what, right? So first of all, policies are imperfect, right? We all know that. So even if products were reserved to be manufactured by small firms, you'll still find large firms manufacturing them, right? So that, again, this is a problem for what? For your difference in difference. Why? Because your control is no longer a control. Your treatment is no longer a treatment, right? Second, well, I shouldn't have said poor quality, but let's say we can improve the quality of data that we have access to, right? And people who have worked with ASI know that this is true. First is just purely sampling. So who is it that ASI samples, right? Second is measurement error. There have been many cases where you find negative output being produced by firms if you add up what they're doing. Even in the panel data, you will find between 2 years, there is a difference in your closing value and opening values, even though they should be the same, right? So one is purely just call. So if you're trying to measure the impact, right, we don't even know what is it that we can use to measure this impact, right? Now, if measurement error, by the way, if measurement error is random, then we are fine. What do I mean by that? Exactly. So it's not like large firms have lesser error than small firms. If I purely just take your output and randomly draw from a normal distribution and add it, right? This beta is not going to be unbiased. It's still going to be unbiased because you're just adding a random shock with zero mean. So average value of this is not going to change. The problem is if it is systematic, right? And here we believe, or there is reason to believe that this might be systematic. Large firms have incentives to hide things, not report, under-report, so on and so forth, which small firms arguably don't, okay? The last point is lack of long panels of firms, right? So the only panel data set on firms that we have in India right now, which is from the government, is the ASI, right? We have the Provis CMIE data set, but basically between the two of them, that's all we have on a panel of firms, right? And that too, now ASI has released till about 2015, so we have 15 years of data, right? But if you look at the data, you know, it's not like you observe one firm for 15 years. There are very few firms that you can actually observe for more than 5 years at a stretch, okay? So really the limitations, specifically on industrial policy in India, is just access to data, right? Can we measure things better, or is there better data measurement that can take place to help us doing this?
Is Provis data like reliable?
Yeah, very reliable. Second is the scale of the policy, right? So now, these are not micro RCTs that, like the example I showed in the morning, with 500 people that we ran in some 10 centers, which no one cares about. These are actually national large policies. So the scale of the policy in itself warrants the following things to think about. One is, so what is the effect, right? How is it different from if I were to run just an RCT? It's different in many ways. One, the direct effect of the policy. I de-reserve something, I look at the direct effect, right? However, there are a lot of these indirect effects coming in from GE. The disadvantage of that is that your control groups are going to get contaminated, right? Because you're getting these feedback loops, essentially, right? Such as what? You can think of competition across firms, within firms, incomes and prices changing through general equilibrium. So what do you mean by income and price effects? Basically, if I de-reserve this, workers are going to get a higher wage, for example. Workers get richer. Now, if you get richer, I'm not only going to consume tables, I'm also going to consume chairs, right? Which means demand for chairs is increasing, right? Which means chair manufacturers are also being affected. even though the policy was only for tables, right? So these income and price effects, upstream, downstream effects, so right? So therefore, this sets us the stage for looking more closely at theory. What can theory tell us to be able to inform what are the sort of regressions or what are the sort of approaches can one take, okay? So in the last part of what I'm going to discuss, last two parts, please. So efficient allocation across products within a firm. So misallocation can happen along two dimensions. One is that firms can grow large or small, which means resources are allocated across firms, or even within firms, firms can allocate more efficiently across products. And what you basically see is, or what I try to argue is that that margin in India is actually extremely important. So for example, one thing, since we're having this discussion, one thing that policymakers were worried about with dereservation is what? Dereservation is protecting small firms, correct? Sorry, reservation is protecting small firms. I dereserve this, all of these guys are going to go out of business, right? Which politically is a huge gamble to take, right? What you actually find when you look at the data is that, or when you, if you believe my model, is some of that happens, but a huge part of the adjustment is actually within firms. So firms downsizing, dropping products, adding products, that seems to be a very vibrant, product churning seems to be a very vibrant margin that firms in India operate on.
This we are looking into ASI data.
Yes. Those are like our only data sets available, absolutely. Okay, so then the second last part that I'm going to tell you is trying to go through a little bit of theory, because I feel it's important to set at least some things right in terms of thinking through how can we think about incorporating these policies. So essentially, I'm laying out one model structure, right? And the model structure is essentially going to be what people have been thinking of applying in a lot of other contexts. It's going to have three ingredients, simple. First, there's going to be a demand side. So you're going to have a bunch of consumers who want to consume a bunch of products. Okay, so first. Which once I get consumers in, I need to get utility in, right? So there's going to have some utility that I'm going to impose. Third, they're going to have income and prices, right? So I have a consumer earns some income, products have some prices, there's a budget constraint, you maximize utility subject to your budget constraint, period. The second ingredient is going to be the supply side, okay? Which is firms. Now firms can be heterogeneous in terms of say productivity or something. Some firms are more productive than others, okay? And some assumption on the production function, was I'm going to take some inputs, capital, labor, material, whatever, put some production function on it to produce one unit of output, okay? And the last part is the structure of the market that we're operating in, okay? So for example, how are you going to define what a sector is or an industry is, right? How am I defining space? So what is the market? Is it a state? Is it a district? Is it the entire country? Second, what is the competition amongst firms? Is it perfect competition? Is it monopolistic competition? Is it a monopoly? And so, yeah, perfect or monopolistic competition, okay? So this is basically a setup. Now we'll go through each of these components and just see what we can learn from the theory side, right? And how these things might make a difference. So the model is basically a trade model. So people who have done international trade will be familiar with these models. But the whole idea is that we are trying to apply this in non-trade settings, okay, so domestic policies. The idea is going to be the following. Firms are going to be heterogeneous in some productivity Z, okay? Z is going to be drawn through some production, some distribution. So take a log normal distribution, take a Pareto distribution. I'm imposing, it's an assumption, okay? This. Consumers are homogeneous, which means what? For me, I don't make a distinction between income or anything about the consumer, all consumers are homogeneous. This is going to be a very macro model. So don't think about this as literally individuals. Think about this as an entire economy or something. Okay? So consumers are homogeneous. They earn some income. So if you look at an economy, where is the income going to come from? Income is going to come from wages, so WL, or it's going to come from profits of firms. Okay? So that's basically my income for a consumer in an economy. Okay? So now I'm going to only outline for this talk the baseline model, just to give you an idea, and then show you that this can be modified to get all the other policies that we have studied so far in a very transparent way. That's the beauty of these models. No, it will be dependent completely. And you'll see exactly in a minute how. Sure. You can have RK here. Bilkul. So this is purely on labor right now. You can extend this to many other inputs. Absolutely. So now what happens? Consumers now have to make some, this is the strongest piece. So, and I'll tell you why this is important and where this is not important. So consumers, I have to put some utility function. One way of doing that is to say utility is some Cobb Douglas across sectors, right? So take furniture industry, automobile industry, petroleum industry, whatever, right? You just say that utility is some consumption bundle across these industries. That's in a Cobb Douglas form. What is the nice thing about Cobb Douglas? Yes, which means what? What is the nice thing about Cobb Douglas functions or utility? The share that goes to one industry is not equal, constant. It's constant. Whether the constant is going to be given by kappa s. Okay? So kappa s is basically the share of my income that goes to sector S, right? That's all. So you might think, oh, like, why do I need Cobb Douglas, blah, blah, blah. Turns out that if you look at aggregate, like, industry level expenditure, it's more or less constant in shares, right? Second, okay, so now I have these industries. Now firms are manufacturing products within these industries, okay? Here the market structure becomes important. So you can have two types of market structures. One is perfect competition, one is monopolistic competition, okay? So this is taking you back to like undergrad micro basically, right? So if I have perfect competition and if I have heterogeneous firms, heterogeneous in the sense, some firms are productive, some firms are not productive, what will be the outcome? Exactly. The entire market will be captured by the most productive firm. Everyone else will not even enter the market. Correct? Okay, do we observe that in the data? Do we ever observe one firm capturing the entire market? Very rarely, right? And so usually in these settings, that's why you use monopolistic competition. What does monopolistic competition give you? This might look very complicated, but all that this is saying is I have different products. Consumers imperfectly substitute between these products. That's all. Which means what? Your chairs and my chairs, right, are not perfect substitutes. If they are perfect substitutes, we're screwed. Because if he's more productive, he's going to charge lesser prices. And so all consumers are going to buy only his chairs. Which means I don't need to be there in the market, right? If they're imperfectly substitutes, right, which means for some reason, he might be better at manufacturing chairs, that's fine. But people still prefer my crappy plastic chairs for some reason. Okay? And what that gives you, essentially, is the existence of multiple firms in a market, which is what we observe in the data. Remember, the theory is not completely abstract, right? This is not to make a theoretical point. Eventually, what I'm going to do is take the theory to the data and try and estimate the entire model. This is basically what is structural modeling. So you'll see structural modeling is nothing fancy. Basically, using micro, undergrad micro with data. That's it. This is the Dixit-Stiglitz model. This is the exactly. If you want to go even more crazy, you can say within a product as well, firms can manufacture different qualities of products, right? If you want to go to that level. In the ASI, you can, because ASI, you see information at the product level. And especially like the dereservation policy, for example, that I study, that there you have to look at products, because products are being dereserved, right? Okay, but so far, so good. So what is this entire thing giving you? That's the whole point. What this entire thing is giving you is essentially a demand curve for firm I. That's it. You take this, you take your first order conditions, you maximize utility, blah, blah, blah. You all do all the theatrics and mechanics. All you're going to end up with is this, which is what? Consumption or demand for good I or firm I is inversely proportional to price. this thing is important. This theta is like a demand shifter, right? Which means what? If I take log C and log P, this is like the intercept. But remember, if I have, so you don't even need this entire setup. I could just have assumed a demand curve like this, right? Because I can always say, this demand curve can be rationalized by a setup that I can explain through the Dirichlet's little model. So why do I need this? So first of all, remember this demand shifter is sector specific, right? So which means across sectors, you have these different demand shifters, first. Second, where we can do more is to endogenize the demand shifter. If I don't build this model, right, then I have to just assume that this is constant, which means what? If I have a policy change, I'm not going to be, I'll be able to tell you how P changes. And therefore, from the demand curve, I'll be able to tell you how C changes. Fine. But I won't be able to tell you if the demand shifter changes because of the policy. That's the whole point. That's why if you have this fancy framework here, you're basically, you know the equation that governs the demand shifter. With me? And so you know how a policy change will change the aggregate price, for example, endogenously because of the policy. And so you can have an additional channel through which consumption changes, which is not just the price changing, but also the shifter changing, okay? So that's basically what I'm saying here. Right. So here I've actually given you the example. So if I solve this entire model specific to that model, this is the demand curve that you're looking at. The P is just in brackets because you can extend this to the sector level or the product level, depending on what level you go to. But essentially, all you're saying is that your consumption is some inverse function of price. That's all you're getting if I rearrange this. And this constant here, which I'm calling eta, you can see is a function of all the aggregate prices, incomes, the Cobb-Douglas share, and so on and so forth, right? And that will be endogenous because of the policy change, okay? So if you've understood this, and if you're here until now, the rest of it is literally like first year undergrad now, okay? Now what are we going to do? Now let's come to the more, we are studying all of this for industrial policy, right? All that we have done right now is to figure out the consumer side. Now let's come to firms. Firms are very simple. What we're going to do is, we're going to say, well, let's say that there are some potential entrants who are going to be heterogeneous in productivity. So some firms are more productive, some firms are not. Productivity distribution is going to be given by some, say, normal distribution, for example, right? Firms pay a fixed cost of entry. So to set up a factory, you need to have a building, you need to hire some people. That I'm going to call fixed costs. Remember, it's important here, the beauty of structural modeling, I mean, it's not a score a class of structural modeling, but the idea is that I'm going to very clearly tell you mechanisms. In RCTs, you don't have any mechanism. I have control treatment, treatment goes, I don't know why, right? Here, I'm explicitly modeling how one thing is affecting the other, right, first. Second, I am modeling what are known and what are unknown. In what sense? In the sense, what is it that once I have my model, I will be able to identify using the data. So in this case, for example, Z is unknown. Z is just productivity. Do I observe productivity in the ASI? No. Right? Do I observe a variable called Z? No. Right? Do I observe a variable called F or fixed costs? No. But as you will see, we can infer this from the data, from some features of the data are going to be suggestive of this, okay? So product redistribution, fine. Manufacturing, this is a production function. So I've only included labor. You can include multiple inputs if you want to. But the idea is that labor and productivity combine together to give one unit of output. So what are you going to find? More productive firms, right? Are also going to be larger in size, correct? Just because, like if I take a Cobb-Douglas function of this. So if I have Y is equal to ZL, right? The more productive you are, the larger you are as well, okay? And of course, this is very simple. You can extend this to more inputs, upstream, downstream. You can go crazy with this. And you actually, you have the machinery now. There's enough computational power for you to go crazy on this and do some nice structural estimations. Okay. Profit function is very simple. What is profit function? So forget the summation. That's only if you go to product levels. But what's the profit? maximize sales, P times Y, minus input costs, M is just some input, right, minus the fixed cost that I have to pay for entry. That's it, right? So now what is the problem with this? If production functions are, this is what? This is constant returns to scale, which means what? If I double labor, output will double, right? So it's constant returns to scale. Okay. So if you know what CR constant return scale is, then suppose I have, where is it? Suppose I simply try and maximize profits, which means what? What am I maximizing? PY minus WL in the simple case, right? Where Y is just equal to ZL, right? What's the problem in doing this? What am I interested in finding? It's a profit maximization. So effectively, I want to find, given this, what is L star? What is Y star? What is pi star, right? I can get that. Now, what is the problem with using constant returns to scale functions, productivity functions? Size is undefined, simple. Why? Because I can always double my labor, output will double, right? If P is constant with perfect competition, for example, right? Then I'm just gonna get what? I'm just gonna get PZ minus W, whole thing times L, correct? So what is L star? It mean anything, it would be infinity, right? I can't pin down firm size with this, right? That's another reason why monopolistic competition helps. Why? Because now size will be pinned down by the demand curve. This is giving you supply, right? But now I have a demand curve. So I can't grow infinitely because I have some demand curve that governs how large I should be, okay? So therefore, this monopolistic competition thing, I maximize profits. You can do this as an exercise. What you find, essentially, once you take the first order conditions, is the following. First, which is obvious, your sales, which is what I'm calling X, and your output, and your labor also, right, will be proportional to how productive you are, which is obvious, right, endogenously, right? Second, inputs are going to be the constant share of sales because it's Cobb Douglas, right? So alpha M is the share that goes to labor or capital, okay? Good. Third, you'll find prices that I charge are some fraction of the marginal cost, right? What is marginal cost? In the simple case, marginal cost is just W with one input, right? That's the cost of producing one unit of output. So marginal cost divided by Z. So the more productive you are, the lesser prices you will charge, conditional on other things. With me? Second, you have markups. This is the markup, right? Which means what? If I take this ratio, MC over Z, once I know this ratio, I know prices. They're just a markup, constant markup. Now, why is that important? Because there's very recent literature by Jan D. Locker and all that tries to argue that markups are actually endogenous as well, right? It's not that, so what, the implication of this is what? The implication of this is if I'm a small firm or a large firm, right? And if I have the same cost, both of us should be charging the same price. That's basically what this means. That does not seem to be the case in the data, okay? One. Lastly, I can use all of this information, put it back in the profit function to finally get profit just as a function of all my exogenous variables. So Z minus, so it turns out to be this form of profits. Now why is that important? I'll come to in a minute, okay? So now when will a firm enter? A firm will enter as long as it makes positive profits or non-zero profits, right? Or non-negative profits, sorry, right? Which means enter as long as pi I is greater than zero. Remember, pi is a function of Z, basically, and the fixed cost. So if I keep on increasing Z for very low values of Z, firms are not going to enter because the fixed costs are too high, right? But as productivity increases above a certain threshold, firms will find it beneficial to enter the market. Is that clear? So what you're going to get is some threshold Z star, a productivity threshold above which firms will enter. Now this might sound very abstract theory. I'm going to tie this down to data in like exactly a minute, so bear with me. Z star is the productivity threshold, which means above that, firms will enter the market. This Z star is dependent on what? This is important. This is where the GE effects come in. This is a function of fixed costs, marginal costs, right? Prices and income. So now if a policy is changing anything in the market, and if there is a general equilibrium effect on prices, either wages or income or prices, right? Essentially what models like these are going to predict is that there should be firm entry. Because Z star is changing, your threshold is changing. So if you look at any of these reduced form papers, that's one way of rationalizing why is it that we should expect firm entry. Is it obvious? Of course we find it, right? But should we be expecting it? And this is a way of rationalizing the fact that we should, like, it's not terrible that we find firm entry going, because Z stars are changing. Okay? Please.
So the way you define the production function, the marginal cost of the firm would be W only.
Correct.
So then how can you say that threshold depends on something which is not under the control of firms?
Sorry, what?
Like W will be defined in the labor market only. So then how can you say that threshold productivity
which is endogenous, that's the whole point.
I mean, it's an aggregate effect.
Yeah, so once I see, what do we mean by endogenous W? Suppose wages go down, which means what? It's cheaper for firms to manufacture, so more firms will manufacture, right? Which means Z star will go down as well, right? That's all that this is saying, essentially. The point I wanted to stress was that these changes are endogenous with the policy. So you can't do difference in difference type of things, because these are aggregate variables. So you're changing entry even in the control group now by doing this. That's the whole point. Okay, once I do this, I'm basically going to close the model. Closing the model as in clearing all the markets. Goods markets, product markets, wage markets, labor markets, all of that can be cleared, basically. Okay, done. This is the model. Okay, the baseline model. It's pretty intuitive, very simple to do. Now what we want to do is, okay, so the theoretical implications of this are, I have shown you basically a model without any constraints. It's all unconstrained. I could easily introduce constraints to this model, right? For example, I can add constraints on firm production, right? So firm size would be what? In this model, a way to model firm size would be to say, if Y is greater than Y star, where the constraint, the Y star is determined by the government, something else happens, right? Or there is a per unit tax, for example, on sales, right? So you could modify, if you understand the mechanics of the basic structure of the model, right, then adding modifications to this is very trivial. I mean, not trivial, but it's simpler, right? You could examine a lot of policies by using the model framework, okay? And when I mean examine, now you have a reason to run any of the regressions we discussed. Why? Because now if I do the policy, right, in the model, then I can look at two equilibria, right? I can look at an equilibrium with the policy. I can look at an equilibrium without the policy, theoretically, right? It's like taking the deltas, right? So del pi over del tau, where tau is some tax. What would happen, correct? If I do that, I can look at what that expression looks like, because that expression is going to contain information on a lot of things, such as all these endogenous things. Now, the good thing about these endogenous things is that one way of controlling them is a time trend. Because these are aggregate, remember? These are aggregate things. So if I have data over time, I could, one way of rationalizing why do you need a time fixed effect in my regression is because I want to control for all of these aggregate variables, right? Why do I need sector fixed effects? Because my fixed costs are sector specific. They don't differ across firms, but they're sector specific. So that's why you might want to put in a sector fixed effect, right? So the point is that the reason theory is important, especially while studying industrial policies, is because there are all of these channels going in, but theory is able to parse out the role of these different channels in affecting different parts of the model, like firm production, consumer side, etc. Okay?
Just one question. So yes. Once the aggregate has been done, I mean, theory, I mean, like, we derive a linear equation out of this, right?
Yes. Yes.
Not
here, but in paper, I can give you papers where you can see this. Yeah, okay. Great. So now, I can add all of these constraints, and you know, I can, these are like bells and whistles. You can add them and make your model much richer, right? And so I've cited a bunch of examples that I'm involved in. I don't know why I cited myself so much, but there are other people working on this. I don't want to take all the credit, but with similar frameworks. Okay, great. Now let's come to estimation. So theory is nice because, well, you get some insights, but the real innovation with cheaper computing is that now you can actually take my theory to the data. Remember, all of these abstract things like productivity and fixed costs, I don't know what they are, right? But now you can look at how I can use the data to identify them. So what are the things I don't know? If you were to believe my theory, what are the things I don't know? I don't know the demand side. So the share, kappa s, right? The elasticities, I don't know. Production function, I don't know alpha m. That's a parameter, right? I don't know my fixed costs. I don't know my productivity, right? And I, even if I assume some structure on productivity, which is make it log normal or Pareto, I don't know the variance and the parameters of these distributions, okay? So now the question is, can I use the model plus the equations that it gives to identify these things, okay? So essentially what you're going to do is, these things are simple, like production function you can do. For example, people have done, like, because it's Cobb-Douglas, so it's simpler. Shares are just constant, you can just look at the shares, approximately. The harder thing are the last two. The last two are really hard. How are you going to identify productivity, right? But if you think about it, let's go back to this part. Remember, sales is a function of productivity, right? And in fact, if I write down the closed form solution of this, sales is effectively some set of constants. Sales will be some set of constants which are sector specific times Z, basically, okay? Or Z to the power some exponent on top. Which means what? This is data. In the ASI, I can observe sales data, right? If you believe my model, I will be able to solve for this endogenous app. So therefore, I can invert the sales distribution to get at moments on my productivity distribution. That's the idea. So if log sales will be log this plus log Z plus gamma times log Z, right? Now you can believe this is just linear regressions. So coming back to, in some sense, this is what you want, like linear regressions, right? Or if I observe the distribution of log sales, right, you know that there's just going to be a mean shifter of the productivity distribution. With me, right? However, the only caveat here which makes this harder is that this is going to be censored at the bottom, because the really unproductive firms are not entering.
That's because of the Z star.
Exactly. So you can observe a censored sales distribution, basically. But that censored sales distribution, so I observe this part of the data, will give me information on the true underlying productivity distribution, right? So of course, if you make different assumptions on productivity, you'll get different answers for this, right? That's where there's a tension between what you assume in your model versus and how you tie it down to the data, okay? Excellent. So in a nutshell, how we're going to do it is the following. I'm going to assume a potential set of entrants. Why? Because what is ASI? Now literally think it back to what you observe in the data. ASI is going to be, say, 1,000 firms, correct? Now these are 1,000 firms conditional on them manufacturing something, right? But here, as we know, there are fixed costs of entry. So some firms would have liked to manufacture, but are not manufacturing. Do I know those firms? Can I find those firms? No. So what do you do? What economists best do? Assume, right? So therefore, you can just assume a potential set of entrants, right? But the important thing is that whatever I do here on, I'll keep that number constant, okay? Second, if I know the number of firms, right? Suppose I know in the chair industry, potential set, I've assumed it to be 100 firms, okay? In the ASI, I find 10 firms, okay, that are manufacturing chairs. What does that tell you? That tells you that the mass of firms that are manufacturing, right, this is basically 0.1. Because 10% of firms are entering, right? Remember, this is Z star. If Z is greater than Z star, you're manufacturing it. So if I know this F of Z, which is either log normal or Pareto, right, and I know the number of firms, then I know this area. Once I know this area, under a normal distribution, I can find out what Z star is, right? Once I do that, what do? I can get Z star. What do you mean by getting Z star? It's data now. I can observe it, right? I can use it as data for anything that I want to do. That's the beauty of structural estimation. Like, you can identify these parameters very nicely, and even though in the data they're not observable, by using some features of the data, you can back out these parameters or these unobservable characteristics of the model. Is that clear? Great. So now, once I know Z star, I know who enters, because I know everyone who is above Z star is going to enter. I know your production functions. I know your prices and all of that. I can solve the model, including making everything endogenous, because I can clear markets, I can do all of that, right? So I can basically solve for the entire model using this, right? And once I do that, so I know all my endogenous objects, like prices and incomes and all of that, wages and all of these things I know now. Once I know that, I can use the zero profit condition to calculate F. Because what? Zero profit means what? My fixed cost has to be equal to my profit, right? Once I solve all of this, it's all data. That's the nice thing. It's all observable now. Once I do that, I can easily calculate F, basically, right? So now I know everything in this model. All of these things are known now. I know F, I know Z, I know the distribution of Z, right? And I know all of these parameters up here. So I'm done, right? So once I do that, then what can I do? Then I can play around with it. I can do simulations, right?
Because the model is ready.
Exactly. All my parameters are known now. So I can just have a computer simulate fake firms under the model. And I can see if I impose different types of policies, what happens to, say, wages or output or productivity or whatever, right? So this is what we call counterfactuals. Counterfactuals as in, remember in RCTs we said that, oh, like the problem is that I can't observe what would have happened to you in the absence of the policy. With fake firms, I can observe that. Because I'm simulating it. I know the model. That's the reason structural model is nice, because you're modeling the decision making of a firm, right? Given certain aggregate constraints, I'm modeling the decision of a firm. So therefore, I can simulate, if I change aggregate conditions, how firms are changing behavior, because I've modeled it. I've imposed that structure, right? So therefore, I can then run counterfactuals, look at welfare. Welfare usually is just utility of the consumer. And then, sure, like, you can put policies, remove policies, go wild with it, and get different numbers, okay? Importantly, I can get at the sources of these gains. Why? Because again, it's structure, right? So instead of saying that firms can choose labor, suppose I say that, oh, like, I'm going to give you labor. Firms can't choose it. I switch this channel off, right? Or another way is to say, suppose I switch the entry-exit channel off. Because one question that you might have as a policymaker is, well, aggregate welfare is growing fine, but is it growing at the cost of firms exiting the market, right? Is it, because large firms are growing, yes. Small firms are exiting though, right? So how much of the welfare gain is coming through the exit margin, right? So how can you deal with that? You can run a counterfactual. In the counterfactual, what can you do? You can say, I'm going to take a set of firms that I observe in the data, right? And I'm going to run my model, but I'm not going to change Z star, which means I'm not going to change my entry decisions. If you're in, you're in, right, as a counterfactual. And I can simulate the model to figure out what would welfare have looked like in that setting. And then compare that change in welfare to whatever the change in welfare was in my normal simulation with all the channels of adjustment possible, right? And then you can figure out how important these different channels are, okay? Great. The other thing you can do is you can look at distributional gains. What do you mean by distributional gains? You can see whether the gains are all being driven by the productive firms or the unproductive firms, right? And if yes, how much are they being driven by? So The point is, once you write down the model, and once you learn how to estimate it, and if you have enough good, rich data to estimate it, you can really unpack a lot of these features that, imagine if I were to just run a regression, you can't do, right? In a regression, you'll say what? Oh, yeah, large firms are growing. Yay. Sure. But the question is, how does that matter in a lot of other endogenous ways, right? How are the distributional gains different? How are other counterfactual policy simulations going to be different? If I did not have this policy, but I'd done another policy, would the effect have been the same? Would it have been different? Right? You can't answer all of these questions with a simple linear regression, right? And so this is slightly complicated, I agree. But I think it's simple enough in the sense that if you invest time, there's a lot that you can do with these policies. And it's not only to speak with industrial policies, structural modeling in general, I guess. Okay? So then, yes. It won't, yeah. It will. Yeah.
So how do we, so then it becomes important to get that value correct.
Correct.
So how do we do that?
So you don't, in the sense that you have to keep that, that's why this thing in brackets. Whatever you assume here, you will keep the same across all counterfactuals. In the sense that if I simulate something else, it's not like for one simulation I'm going to keep this as 10, in the other simulation I'm going to change it to 100. It won't be a mistake, because you're that's the point. You're comparing changes. You don't care whether the average number is 1 or 2. You're comparing, if policy A is giving me a number of 1, is policy going to give me a number greater than 1 or less than 1? So it's the difference that matters. So therefore, you might change this potential entrance from 10 to 100, and instead of getting 1, you'll get 2. But then the question is, what happens when I put a different policy? Okay. So just to conclude in the last 5 minutes or so, now let's, given this setup, now let me just throw out some open questions for you guys to think about if you're interested in this. Looking ahead, what research are we looking at? Or what do I feel, subject to my understanding, very limited, of this entire literature? So first is, going forward, as industrial policy examiners or researchers, it's interesting to look at the whole idea of misallocation. Misallocation coming from the fact that it's not only across firms, that's well known, but also within firms. Firms are, I mean, people are not stupid in the sense that they are playing on margins within firm allocations, right? As well as across firm. And how different policies are affecting these ideas of misallocation is, I think, important. Second, linking economic development in firms, right? So linking the fact that, you know, why do we have so many small firms in India? Or, I mean, in most developing countries. It's a very open question. Is it efficient? Is it not efficient? Can we make it efficient? Should we be killing off these small firms? Right? Maybe they play a role in society that we just don't. I mean, economics, remember, whatever I say is in the lens of that model. If you change the model, you might have completely different predictions on what optimal policy should look like. Right? And so examining this link between economic development and firms. Second, what you find is, you know, certain patterns that people haven't been able to explain. Like, for example, large firms, if I compare a large firm in India to a large firm in the US, what you find is large firms generally tend to grow slower in India as compared to the US. Okay? So why? Are there, I mean, it's always easy to say, oh, like the context is different, but no. Are there economic reasons? It might be context, but let's first rule out economic reasoning and then come to like culture and all of these abstract things that you can't measure. Okay? Second, from farms to firms, if you want to really link economic development to industrial policy, you need to think about the link between agriculture and industry services. How are these things being affected, right? And that's where I think I'm thinking of starting some new work, which is very interesting, which is that when you talk to policymakers on why are they supporting small-scale industries, right? From an economic standpoint, it's very clear it's inefficient. Why? Because large firms are more productive. They should be getting more resources from the economy as opposed to small firms. But when you talk to policymakers, the insight you get is that, well, small firms are also people who are transitioning between agriculture and industry, right? And so in some sense, to protect them is not completely inefficient, the way we think about as economists in terms of efficiency, right? So can we really nail that dimension down? So can we really see how important is it this link between farms and firms. Suppose I take rainfall shocks, or if I take floods, or if I take droughts, right, in agricultural areas. I look at the transition in those areas to industry or migration. Right? Those will give us insights on how people are responding to this transition or economic, like structural transformation. Second, specifically in Indian context, you have to think about infrastructural constraints. So now, for example, there have been a bunch of papers that talk about electricity and shortage of electricity, which can be measured in the night lights data. By the way, this is being combined with, you know, you can combine with a lot of cool data sets, right? So night lights is one data set. Geospatial data sets that people are now using all over the place. People are getting creative with like cell phone data sets and stuff like that as well. So, you know, go crazy if you want to. Second, whatever, one, two, three, fourth, right? You might want to think about corruption and monitoring. Of course, it's really hard to measure, right? And so there's a really cool paper that I've cited here, which try and look at measuring like, corruption through a simple model, but just looking at firm size distributions, right? Because if firm size distributions were, in some sense, optimal, right, it should mimic a smooth bell curve, right? But you do find, you know, bunching across different cutoffs, right? Especially size cutoffs, right? You'll find bunching, which means there is excess mass as opposed to what a smooth distribution would have predicted. Now, the idea in their paper is essentially, can I use that excess mass to quantify how much monitoring and corruption there is, right? Which is, I think is a very neat and a very cool idea to do. You can talk about political interference, right? So how does all of this industrial policy play into politics and political changes to industrial policies? Sam Asher and people have nice papers on this. Last, different types of labor. Of course, labor is not homogenous, right? It is divided along different types. Females, contract versus permanent laborers, high-skilled versus low-skilled laborers, migrant versus native laborers, so on and so forth, right? And so can we say something about how industrial policies are going to affect, not on average, a labor. Like here, I assume labor was homogenous. L is just L. But I could have this as high-skilled and low-skilled. And so you'll have different implications of the policy on high- and low-skilled labor, for example, right? And so can we talk about something in that? And the last is just studying recent reforms. Like going ahead, India has had a bunch of reforms in the last, literally last couple of years. And so looking forward to some analysis that people might be able to do on studying these reforms. Okay, so that's all. Thanks so much.